not a mountain too tall. There's not a problem so small that Jesus can't resolve. In time you get involved. It's our God, he cares about us. So
yeah. Thank you.
I wanna be more like you. Soul that you work through. I wanna be more like you. I wanna be more like you, Jesus. I wanna be more like you. I wanna be a vessel that you work through. I wanna be more like you. And I wanna be more like you, Jesus. I wanna be more like you. Be a vessel that you work through. I wanna be more like you. Lord, I wanna be more like you. Jesus, I wanna be more like you. Be a vessel that you work through. I wanna be more like you. Lord, I wanna be more like you. Jesus, I wanna be more like you. And I wanna be a vessel that you work through. I wanna be more like you. Sing it again. I wanna be more like you, Jesus. I wanna be more like you. Vessel that you work through. I wanna be more like you. Anointing, fall on me. Anointing, fall on me. Let the power of the Holy Ghost use anything, Lord, use me. You can use anything, Lord, use me. Take my hands and my feet, touch my heart, Lord, speak to me. You can use anything, Lord, you can use me. You can use anything, Lord, you can use me. Yes, you can use anything, Lord, use me. Oh. So take my hands and my feet, touch my heart, Lord, speak through me. You can use anything, Lord, use me. We sing, you can use anything, Lord, use me. Take my hands and my feet, touch my heart, Lord, speak through me. You can use anything, Lord, use me. You can use anything, Lord, use me, Lord. You can use anything, Lord, use me. My life. vessel that you work through. I wanna be more like you. Lead us in time of prayer today. And as he comes, amen. I know this is familiar. It's almost preaching to the choir-esque today, but there's one thing that the Lord never denies, and that is desire. When we come and we're hungry, when we come and we're thirsty, amen. When we come, amen, to drink of that everlasting water. It doesn't matter if you want him for the first time or you want more of him, a renewal, a refreshing, a reviving. He never turns his back on desire. Amen. And I encourage you today, as we have worshiped the Lord, as we continue in this service and beyond even this service, amen, continue to seek the Lord. Continue to search for him. Continue to reach for him. Even if it feels like you're groping in the darkness, amen, he'll never turn his back on desire, amen. And we're thankful for that. We feel his presence in this place today, amen. Let's go to the Lord in prayer tonight.
Praise the Lord. Thank you for joining us today for Oasis service. Wherever you are, you have turned your home into a temple, and we're thankful that you could join us today. And we just want to continue our prayer focus for this week, and from June 20 to June 26. It is for our Filipino community this week, and many of our churches are very blessed to have a great representation from the Filipino community, as well as several churches with majority of Filipinos. What a blessing to our district. Let's pray this week that God uses those within this community to have even a greater impact on our provinces. Pray for the leading and guiding of the Holy Ghost to direct all of us to reach those within our own communities, cities, to a greater walk with God. Also pray for those that are waiting on their families. We saw Brother Ramil, his family just joined him here in Canada, and there are many more waiting on their families to reunite with them. They're waiting on paperwork, citizenship, nomination, permanent residence, and we know they're praying, and we just wanna pray with them. And I have the experience of waiting on my family here, and I know how it felt. So let's continue to pray for them. Amen?
Amen.
And Revelation 14, verse 6 says, "And I saw another angel fly in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel to preach unto them that dwell on earth, and to every nation, and every kindred, and every tongue, and people." Amen? Let's pray today. Could you all join me in prayer today for this community And we also want to pray for Sister Hall, who hurt her back. We want to ask for prayers for her as well. We're going to be praying for her. And we also continue to pray for Brother Jareem for health and strength. Amen?
Amen.
So let's all join together and pray. Lord Jesus, we love you. Yes. We give you thanks for this day that you have made. We will rejoice and be glad in it, Lord. We just want to thank you for your mercy and grace that has kept us, Lord, so that we could be here together, joined in one accord to worship you, to praise you, to lift you up, to give you praise for your goodness and your wonderful works unto the children of men. Our prayer today, this week, prayer focus is for the Filipino community, Lord. We thank you for having such a great people and a great nation amongst us, O Lord. Your word said that this gospel shall be preached as a witness unto all nations, not just some, oh God, for everyone, Lord Jesus. Oh God, we are so thankful that we have, we pray for Brother Abigwani, oh God, who leads a church, oh God, of Filipinos, Lord Jesus. And we are so thankful. We ask you that you continue to lead and guide everyone to call on this community, Lord Jesus. Send them to us, Lord. Oh God, those hearts you've been knocking on so long, Lord Jesus, we ask you to turn them to flesh, Lord. And we pray for this community also, those that are waiting on their families to reunite with them, those are waiting on their paperwork, Lord Jesus, nomination, citizenship, permanent residence, Lord Jesus. They have been praying, Lord, and we know you'll open doors for them. The doors you open, no man shut it, Lord Jesus. We join in one accord, and we pray for these needs we bring before you today, Lord Jesus. We pray for Sister Hall, Lord Jesus. Oh God, touch her with your healing virtue, oh Lord Jesus. Brother Jareem, oh God, continue to touch him, Lord Jesus, with your healing virtue. Give health and strength, Lord. And for those who have needs that are unspoken today, Lord Jesus, each and every individual have a need, Lord. And we ask you, oh God, you know, even before we ask, Lord Jesus, you know, and we are confident that you have answered these prayers, oh God. You said we have not because we asked that. So we asked you today, in the name of Jesus, the name above all names, Lord Jesus, it is done in your name. And we ask that your spirit be with us in this service, and let your spirit be with those that are at home, those that have turned their home into a sanctuary, Lord Jesus. We are so thankful, and we ask you to open up our hearts to these words today, your words, Jesus. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord, everybody. Everybody in the house, praise the Lord. Everybody online, praise the Lord. Amen. I didn't hear you. Amen. It's great to be together tonight in the house of the Lord and feel the presence of the Lord as we've worshiped him. How many's felt the presence of the Lord as we've worshiped him? Hallelujah. Why don't we just take a moment and love him one more time tonight? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. God, we love you tonight. Hallelujah. Oh, we thank you today, God, for your goodness, for your presence, your touch. We thank you, Lord, for being with us tonight, oh God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. God bless you. You may be seated for a few moments. I want to say again what a wonderful privilege it is to be able to be in the house of the Lord. And for those of you that have joined online, I want to encourage you to come out to the house of the Lord. Amen. Here is a wonderful place to be able to join together in fellowship, in spirit, and in truth, and worship the Lord together. And there's no place I'd rather be than in the house of the Lord. Amen. What a wonderful privilege it is, and especially appreciative of being able to be in the house of the Lord after all these months of being just kind of hemmed in and shut off. But here we are tonight, lifting up the name of the Lord. Praise God. Amen, amen. As we talked about last week and on Sunday, we are starting into a series that is based on the book on prayer. And Sunday, we are going to be trying to give every family one of these. And it is a book, I believe, that will be a great blessing to your family. And in this book is 21 days of prayer with a prayer focus and subject for every day of that 21 days. So we're going to follow that through. Starting Sunday, we're going to start teaching through some of the various days, and then you're going to have your book to take home, and you can go back through that, read it, study each day, and make that your prayer focus. And we're all going to be praying together. And I just believe that God is going to do some wonderful things. When we pray, things happen. Amen. Things happen. And I don't know about you, but I want something to happen. Amen. I want God's presence and God's spirit to really work in ways we have not seen him in quite some time. And especially during this pandemic time, we have been just sort of, everything's been on hold. But I believe that through the power of prayer, our lives can be revolutionized, can be empowered, can be anointed. And through our collective efforts, we can make a difference in our world. Amen. Our immediate world, that world that touches each of us, which is slightly different for everybody in this room and everybody that's online tonight. You touch people, you have a world of influence, and I believe that God is going to work through you, amen, as we draw near to God in prayer tonight. Praise God. And so we're going to just talk a little bit more introductory thought tonight on a prayer taken from some of the statements and so on in the book that we are going to be using as a prayer guide. And we're going to turn tonight to the book of Genesis, chapter 4, and verse 26. I didn't realize until I got up here that I hadn't put on the lapel mic, and I'm already not used to holding the microphone. Don't like it very much. Amen. All right. I can do more with two hands than I can with one. Genesis chapter 4 and verse 26 tells us of a time when God gave to Adam and Eve a son in the stead of Abel, who was slain by his brother Cain. Verse 26 says, "And to Seth, to him also there was born a son, and he called his name Enos." And the next statement is what I want to remind us about tonight. This is the very first statement of its kind in the scripture. And it says, "Then began men to call upon the name of the Lord." Amen. Now, there's a lot of thought and conjecture with the Bible commentaries and the different students of the scripture over centuries of time as to what that actually means, and there are various thoughts about this, but I believe tonight that it was here that men began to experience a resurgence in their relationship with God. And there were individuals like Enos and his particular day and time where men began to call upon the name of the Lord. And the reason why that is significant is because in the beginning, everybody say, in the beginning. In the beginning, God planted man, his creation, in the garden and The scripture actually calls it the garden of God. And in that garden, part of the equation of relationship between man and God involved God's voice in their lives. Amen. Genesis chapter 3 and verse 8 says, "And they heard the voice of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day, and Adam and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God amongst the trees of the garden." And so I believe that what we see here is a little glimpse of what happened essentially in the daily activities of life in the garden of God, that there was a voice of God that came among them. Now, the interesting phrase here, the voice of the Lord God walking in the garden. And it is a very interesting statement that is made here relative to describe what it was for God and man to be able to commune together. The greatest repercussion, if we could put it that way, I believe that man suffered when iniquity came and sin came into the human family, was that they were thrust from the presence of God. And no longer would they enjoy this wonderful relationship where they could actually have communication. They could talk with God, and God could talk with them. Even in this setting of scripture that we've read, when Adam and Eve realize they have sinned and they hide themselves amongst the trees of the garden to not be disclosed or to be discovered by God, and yet here they hear the voice of God calling them and walking in the garden. And it was so that this was a practice that God had with his creation. And I believe that gives us a little glimpse and understanding that God desires to speak to us and to be spoken to by us. Amen. He created it that way. Sin disrupted that. Sin came. Adam and Eve were thrust out of the garden. And in that particular setting, just went about life, reconstructing their life. Now having to labor to be able to live and to go through all the motions of life. And eventually came to them their sons, Cain and Abel. And then in Cain's jealous fit of rage, Abel's life is taken. Cain is changed forever and marked. And then God brings to them another son, Seth, in his place. And from the generation that followed Seth comes a generation in which men began to call again upon the name of the Lord. So there was a period of years when that communication was ultimately completely silent. But now, again, men are calling upon the name of the Lord. What I'm talking to you tonight about as a prelude to our time for the next 21 days is simply prayer, God's great idea. Amen. God wanted prayer. God wanted communication. Now, probably the ideal of that communication was found in the garden, but sin disrupted that. And so from that, the communication that God has appropriated for us, has made possible for us, is what we call prayer. Amen. And communication was God's practice from the beginning of man's creation. And it is still today God's desire. He wants to talk to you, and he wants you to talk to him. And he eagerly awaits hearing our voice, because this is what he, amen, desires tonight. Hallelujah. Amen. Psalm 65:2 says, O thou that hearest prayer, unto thee shall all flesh come. Amen. What a testimony by the psalmist to the truth of how God has designed and instituted prayer. Prayer is God's great idea. Amen. I said prayer is God's great idea. Amen. And in this little simple statement by the psalmist, amen, he tells us such a powerful truth in different ways. First of all, amen, that we understand God designed prayer. We understand that God hears prayer. And because he is a God that hears prayer, he is a God in which all of us, all flesh, shall come. Amen. And so he is a prayer hearer. Amen. He waits for us to make that communication, to make that connection. You know, the sad thing of our world today is prayer has become out of vogue in our world, even within the general Christianity world. Prayer is a much misunderstood entity, even in Christianity today, even sometimes in apostolic churches today. Amen. We are able today to fill up so many more things. We have more ministries, we have more functions, we have more things that we can do, and we go home and we pride ourselves in the fact that we have done all these religious exercises, and we feel good because we've been in the presence of God, not knowing that all the while God desires to hear from me, from you as an individual. Amen. O thou that hearest prayer, unto thee shall all flesh come. Amen. It is the design of deity. It is God's great idea. He instituted prayer in lieu of what was lost in the garden for us to keep our communication with him open. And he wants to be included in your life. Amen. He wants to be your God moment by moment, not just, you know, when it's church day or church time. He wants to be your every moment God. In the book, this is mentioned, you'll read it. The prayer equation is what I called it. Amen. Where it says much faith plus much love equals much prayer. Little faith plus little love equals little prayer. No faith plus no love equals no prayer. And this is so very true. So very true. When we have much faith and much love for Jesus, we will go often to him, amen, in prayer. We'll seek his counsel. We will seek his will in our life. We will, amen, listen for his voice of direction and help. Amen. Prayer is a very interesting thing. First of all, I think our own life experience should tell us that the first thing about prayer is an instinct. Amen. When you're really in a jam, what do? I know of atheists and agnostics that in a moment of crisis prayed. They didn't know who they're praying to, what they were saying. They just knew they needed help. What does that tell us? It tells us that there's an instinct in us to call upon the name of the Lord. Amen. To go to God in prayer. And so it's not something that comes natural to us as human beings. Prayer is many times very difficult for us. Hello? Amen. We've got to force ourselves sometimes to prayer. Pray. Why? Because it's not in our nature to do so. Amen. But it's something God designed. It's his big idea. Amen. Prayer is not only an instinct, but prayer is a mystery. Amen. The mysteriousness of prayer is an argument for its reasonableness. It is not a thing which common men would have thought of or gone after for themselves. And from the standpoint of our humanity, it's mysterious, amen, because it's not according to our nature. And then prayer is a revelation. Prayer is a revelation. Many things waited for the coming of Christ to reveal them, but prayer didn't wait. In other words, there were many things that waited for that promised Messiah. But all the way back to the book of Genesis, prayer is enjoined. And through prayer, amen, we have a certain insight into the supernatural, the realm beyond our own ability. Amen. Religion without prayer could not be. And so Christ had no need to teach it as a novelty or as a duty or as a just something that we must do, but he taught it as, amen, something we ought to do. The disciples watched and observed the Lord as he lived his life, his natural life among them. And the thing that they noted about him, they noted that he prayed. And finally one day they come to Jesus and they say, Lord, teach us to pray. Now, if you stop and think about that for a moment, you realize that the Lord did not say, well, you really don't need to pray. Or, well, it's just something I do, but you don't have to do. No, they came to him with a sincere request, Lord, teach us to pray. And the Lord's statement was, amen, when he was asked, he said, when you pray, say after this manner. So he did not say to them, he did not downplay prayer, but he showed it, he exemplified it with his life. And not only did he exemplify it with his life, he also, when asked to and prompted to, readily taught his disciples of the different things that can happen in prayer. And it's a wonderful study. You could go through the Lord's Prayer. You can go through it statement by statement. But I believe the primary the primary purpose of prayer in our lives, beyond the initial, our Father which art in heaven, our praise and worship, is thy will be done. Amen. Aligning ourselves with the Spirit of God, aligning ourselves in harmony with God and his will in our lives. And I believe that all the other things are needful. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us as we forgive others and so on. All of those are important in their own place. But when we get ourselves in prayer, prayer is designed to align ourselves with God's will in our lives. Maybe that's why it's so difficult. Hello? Amen. Because we don't always want God's will, we want our will, right? But when we pray, amen, when we pray. You know, Corinthians, Paul writes, said, we with an open face, beholding him as in a glass, you remember that scripture, are changed into his image from glory to glory. And I think when I read that often, I think immediately of prayer. Because there's no place like prayer where a person can see themselves in the light of the glory of God. Amen. So prayer invokes God's will in our life, and it also is a disclosure on me. I get in prayer, all of a sudden I begin to think about and remember the things that the Spirit has been directing me, amen, speaking to me. Sometimes I did not even realize the Spirit had been speaking to me in the recesses of my heart until I'm in prayer, and all of a sudden those things come crashing in. And there I'm able to see myself in that glass, to be able to understand how God's will and his purpose in my life is to be acted out and enacted in my life. And so a lot of times, I think many times, we resist prayer because, first of all, it's not in our nature, and secondly, when we get there, we know we're going to have to deal with God's will in our lives, and we will, thirdly, see ourselves in our prayers. Amen. So there was no question by the Lord. When the disciples asked him, "Lord, teach us to pray," that he didn't say, "Well, why did you ask me about that?" Because prayer was something he exampled in such a fashion that the disciples automatically knew they needed to pray. They just needed to know how to pray. Amen. And so prayer, in some of the introductory remarks of the book, it mentions this: prayer has no substitute. You can't find anything that substitutes prayer. Now, we try to substitute, but in our modern world today, we try to supplant it with something else, some other mechanism that we incorporate in our walk with God. But prayer really has no substitute. You can't modernize it. You can't change its complexity. You can't make it to be changed by our technology world. You can't exchange it for something that's more comfortable. Hello? Prayer is prayer. Amen. And it refuses to be substituted or changed in our lives. Oh, what power comes to us in our lives with prayer. Prayer must always exist in the lives of God's people. Must always exist. Amen. This statement was a powerful statement in there. Each generation must build its altars and illuminate the darkness. Our world is in darkness tonight. And Jesus said to the disciples, "You are salt and you are light." We are the savor of the world. And if we don't have the savor, if we don't have that ingredient in us, how is this world going to know Jesus? Amen. We are the light of the world. We're the city that is set upon a hill that was positioned in such a way that it could not be hid. Amen. We are God's light in this generation. Every generation has to have somebody that's willing to push back the darkness, to illuminate in the midst of darkness. And so each of us tonight, both individually and collectively tonight, each of us in our generation must build an altar. Must build an altar. Must build an altar. Amen. And illuminate the darkness that is around us. Oh, hallelujah. Amen. There is no, even though it's not our nature, even though it's uncomfortable, there is nothing as powerful and as wonderful as coming into the presence of God in prayer. Amen. Coming into his presence. Oh, hallelujah. What a wonderful thing it is to be able to pour your heart out to the Lord and know he not only hears you, but he understands. He already understood before you ever came, but he wanted to be included in the equation and to pour out our heart to God and know he's hearing us and that he's working on our behalf and that he is leading and guiding us through the challenges of our life. Amen. Aren't you glad tonight to have a prayer hearing God? Hallelujah. Why don't we stand together tonight and let's just lift up our hearts and our voices to the Lord tonight. Hallelujah. Amen. Prayer is God's great idea. He wants us to come to him tonight. He wants us to share with him tonight. He wants us to seek his face. Hallelujah. Oh God, tonight we praise you tonight. Lord Jesus, we praise you. Oh God, for this avenue that you've given us, Lord. to being able to call upon your name, O God, and Lord Jesus, to lay our very heart before you tonight, O God. Oh, hallelujah. We come to you tonight, Lord. We pray tonight, God. Lord Jesus, oh, with open hearts tonight, Lord, we pray that, God, you would work in our lives tonight, that we would be aligned with your will tonight, oh, God, that, Lord, your purpose might be worked out in our lives, and, Lord, that you would lead us and guide us every day, every step of the way. Hallelujah. We praise you tonight. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Tonight, God, take us on a journey into your presence tonight. Take us on a journey into your presence tonight, Lord. Hallelujah. Oh, God, we praise you. We praise you. We praise you. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. 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 21 days of prayer. We're going to do it together. Amen. But you don't have to wait till Sunday. You can start right away. Hallelujah. Amen. You know, God is waiting to hear your voice. Amen. He's waiting to hear your voice. He's anxious to hear your voice. Amen. Hallelujah. Oh, let's love him one more time tonight. Thank you, Jesus. God, we thank you tonight. We praise you. How awesome you are tonight. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. Amen. 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 God is so good tonight. Looking forward to walking through this series and letting God do some wonderful things in our lives. Amen. Brother Brandon, lift your voice tonight. Dismiss us in prayer. Thank you, Lord Jesus. God, we pray. Hallelujah. We thank you tonight, Jesus. We thank you tonight, Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Praise God, praise God. In Jesus' name, amen, amen. God bless you. Dismissed in Jesus.
Your mercy towards me, your loving kindness towards me, your tender mercy. Great is your grace. Help me say, help me say.